Okay. Well, that was certainly a lot of energy in those in those talks. So, in fact, we're going to try to capture a little bit of that energy in this session, in that we're going to actually try to run it more like a workshop panel. So each of the speakers will give their presentation during that time that we're sort of swapping out. If you have a clarification question or something that, you know, that you really want to comment on, we can go ahead and do that. But we'd really like you to hold till we've gone through the panel and be thinking as you're listening to the presentations to maybe a conceptual question or a general question, because what we'd like to try to do is get a conversation going across the panel and a conversation going back and forth. So rather than the traditional talk question, we're gonna try to get this more like a true sort of workshop panel and see if we can pull out some things that may not just pop up as a question. So again, you know, just to sort of reintroduce myself, I'm Susan Fitzpatrick. I'm president of the James S. McDonnell Foundation. And I'm just gonna give a few framing remarks as a way to situate the funders panel to some extent. So we have representatives of government funders, and you can think about them as using public funds for the public good. And we have representatives, myself and from the Sloan Foundation, that does private funding, which in some ways you can think about is also private money that, because of our tax code, is not turned over into the public coffers, but is also meant to serve the social good and the public good. So there's a, in many ways, although our mechanisms and our cultures might be quite different, in some ways both the public and private funding represent a similar kind of investment. So what's, I'm gonna talk a little bit about from the philanthropic perspective, that what I think makes philanthropy important and strong is that it offers this distributed decision-making, including a diverse set of values as to how the funds should be invested, which may very well mean that ideas that are heterodox to the reigning trends or work that goes and re-examines common wisdom assumptions. As soon as I hear somebody say everybody knows, it often means nobody knows. So we can go back and sort of revisit some of those questions. And as was brought up earlier, sometimes private philanthropy can pay for things that it's not that easy for federal governments to pay for, certain kinds of research, and there's been a real tradition and history of that, particularly in the US. But I have to say that philanthropy has not been very scientific about the way that we support science. I don't want to paint everyone with the same broad brush, but I think because of our bias towards thinking about this distributed decision-making and this diversity of decision-making, to some extent it has made us reluctant to cede too much to, let's say, some of the models that we've been hearing about today, even though the foundation has supported that kind of work. How much of that approach do we actually use in our own funding decision-making? And it's probably quite small. So some of this is that I think we do have to begin to, as resources become more and more limited, we do have to begin to think about where should we be placing our funding and what kind of guidance and modeling should we be using to help us make those decisions, particularly in our context where every decision to fund something is a decision not to fund something. So how can we be certain that we are putting our limited resources where it might be able to do the most good as we are responsible for? It also means, what do we mean by the best? Or what do we mean by what is the right place for us to be doing that? So I think, you know, there is, I think, a challenge to all of us about whether, how we can be investing more in both our data sharing, in the development of these models, and in the use of these models in our own decision making. And I think, you know, that's what you'll hear a little bit about from the panel today. I just want to end my little introductory remarks with a response to sort of Kadi's funding model that she presented this morning, because certainly most foundations use what I would call eminence-based decision-making, right? Not evidence-based decision-making. We, like many funders, will pull a panel of experts together, and then we review proposals and we base our funding decisions on that. So I'm attracted to these alternative models to begin to think about, but I think sometimes we also have to think about what happens when we fundamentally change social norms. So while the current funding decision making may have gotten and drifted terribly off course, there might actually be reasons to bring people together for a funding decision, even if it might not look different ultimately from if you just used a model to make your decision making. There is the development of scientific and social norms and the reinforcement of that through conversation, right? There is the idea that you are creating a community. Our advisory panels who review for us will often say when a proposal is being looked at, this is an interesting and probably a really good project. It's not a McDonnell project, right? So sort of capturing what does that mean might be very difficult for a small funder working with a small data set. So I think it really challenges us as we think about going forward with some of our scientific and computational models, how do we also include in there intangibles or values that might not be even well articulated, but are going to have to be very critically important in the scope of decision making. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to the panel, and I am not going to go through their bios and where they got their PhDs and what awards they've won in the last 6 months. We're just gonna come up, their bios are online, you have all that information. I'd rather that we use the time for discussion. So I'm gonna invite my colleague from the NIH to come up, and I think there's your presentation right there, and take it away.
Great. Thank you so much. And I was thinking of all the things that we model. One of the things that we actually don't have to model is whether it will rain tomorrow in Washington, D.C. So anyways, on a lighter note, this is a smorgasbord. I'm warning you, there will be some things that I will go very quickly through. It's been a process of sort of subtraction as I've been listening to what my colleagues have said. I've said, okay, I don't need to show that slide. But I thought I would keep a complete set for those of you who would like some of this information later, and I'm trying to serve several purposes at the same time. So forgive, in some sections I'll be going very quickly, in others I will sort of read the body language, and if you seem interested, I will spend more time on it. So let's start. Okay. All right, so the basic outline, how we fund research, a few specific funding announcements. The case study is one of the things I'm going to gloss over because we've had plenty of things from NIH here today. And then I hope to spend a little bit of time at the end. I've sort of thought through, a better title may have been when models are not used, why are they not used? So I've sort of thought through for discussion purposes what some of the issues have been in the past. Okay, what I'd like to get from this slide is those of you who've worked with the NIH know that the NIH is definitely on the less risk side of the equation, especially compared to DARPA and other organizations. So this shows that, and it also shows that the work that we do is definitely at the very basic end of it. This is the migraine slide. And there are 27 institutes and centers. 24 of them have grant-making authority. We are known as the disease body part place, but there's also organ system and stage of life, and there are some non-categorical institutes like the one that I'm at that are focused on overarching themes and goals. Okay, this is our mission. The only thing I want to point out here is the last one, which is preparing a diverse and talented biomedical research workforce, because that has made it into our 2016 priorities. How we fund research, most of you probably know, but I'm just going to reiterate that we fund projects mostly. There's some programs that fund people and infrastructure, but it's mostly investigator initiated. There is some institutes what's called directed research or requested from funding announcements. The mechanisms, I actually went into my internal files to see how many different granting mechanisms we have. We have 237. which is pretty amazing. But they break down into these groups, so research grants, the R-series, career development, fellowship training, center grants, things like that. This is the Snellen chart, but it is useful information for those of you who are interested and have certain assumptions about NIH. We fund about 1 out of 5, but as you can see, there's quite a bit of variation, or maybe you can't see unless you're very young and have really good eyesight. But there's this single digit success rates to a high of, I think, 27%. So there is quite a range. The basic categories of grant programs are this single or multiple PI R01. There are small grant programs. There's R21s, which are more exploratory, and some center mechanisms. There is also a program that started a little while ago that is more interested in funding the person. So this is a little bit more high risk. And so those of you who have heard about the Pioneer Awards, the New Innovator Awards, the Early Independence Awards, these are sort of efforts to get around the idea that you can only fund a project and take a little more risk and fund people. Okay, part two. So one of the reasons that I was invited is that I'm leading a group called the Scientific Workforce Analysis and Modeling Program, and Cadi was a member of that group, as you'll see in the list. It was a cooperative agreement. It started in 2010, and it was the first organized effort at the NIH to really study the kinds of issues that are of importance to this meeting. As I will talk about very quickly, that has a natural end in a couple of years. So I wanted to put up on the screen, there are a couple of other funding announcements, and again, you'll get these slides later, but there are a couple things that may be used to fund this kind of research. Until we figure out a more focused way, probably the best approach is what's called a parent R01, and I can advise you one-on-one on how to go about doing that. But if you wanted to go in and look at specific funding announcements, these are two that may cover the kind of research that is of relevance to this meeting. One of them is called modeling behavior, a social behavior, and the other one is system science and health and the behavioral and social sciences. Okay, so a little bit about SWAM. I'm probably going to go very quickly, but this was, as I said, the first effort to use systems-based computational models to understand the dynamics of the workforce in the United States. It was started by Jeremy Berg, who was our director back then. There were 8 awards. Four currently active. OBSSR is co-funding, that's the Office of Behavioral and Social Science Research, is co-funding on one looking at the behavioral and social sciences workforce. The formal program will end in 2018. That doesn't mean that we're not interested, just means we haven't figured out yet what the future is going to look like as far as us soliciting in this area. And as you've heard from other colleagues at NIH, NIH is incredibly interested in these areas. Just a lot of the work is being done in the Office of the Director by NIH staff under contract. It's the grant piece that we haven't quite figured out yet, and that will be one of my responsibilities. This is another Snellen chart. This is the 8 funded grants. Again, I'm not going to spend time on this one in particular, and I probably will not spend a lot of time on the findings, except to say that there are a couple of really interesting ones. One faculty position for every 6.3 PhDs in biomedical sciences. So when we talk about the oversupply, that we actually put some numbers on them. I think the third one is also kind of interesting, increasing federal funding, that US citizens stay in postdocs longer with no change in publications, but this project found that foreign postdocs produce more papers, but they did not change how long they stayed in postdoc positions. So this project has produced some pretty interesting papers, and I can get you all those references later. Cadi's work is the first 2 bullets of many. I could have had just 6 slides on Cadi, but we decided to spread around the wealth, but her contribution to the project was pretty significant. There were two also that I find interesting, that women's careers may be enhanced by helping them identify and compete in high growth subfields such as biomedical engineering. So it turned out that the guys were able to succeed more in the workforce because they jumped on emerging trends a lot quicker and they were pushed in that direction. So, okay, part three, I think there's only two slides and I'm just gonna, because again, you've seen some stuff from the NIH. So there was a basic question that was asked of the NIH director, wanted to know how we stabilize the age distribution. So they wanted to know how many new R01s would have to come in to actually do that. And so this is actually an example where a model really did change policy. And the policy has been in place since, I think it's on the next slide. The policy has been in place since 2009, and it has worked pretty well. Because for a while, the average age of getting your first grant at the NIH was creeping up higher and higher. And so people were really worried about that. So they ran a model, and it's actually been used. Okay, part four. And again, the better title would be when they're not used, because we have seen examples today where models have been used. But I would suggest that they're being underused at best. So this is just sort of my sense, and I don't have data, sorry, but this is as the result of 30 years of experience and just sort of my own take on this. So the first one is incomplete buy-in. You have often a process that's not open and transparent enough, and through the poor communication, you really don't engage everybody, and so you start from the very beginning with incomplete buy-in. Clearly, limitations of the input data, I think, are a problem. Untenable assumptions, I think, are important. There are cases where the wrong measures and metrics were chosen, and I think that often is a barrier. Too much time is needed. I can't tell you the number of times that I've seen the decision made 2 months before the modelers have the results. And that's often due to changing realities and changing needs, but it's also, this stuff takes a lot of time and decision makers often don't have that time. They may start the process, but then, wow, this took longer than I thought. So I think that is important. Of course, the last one on this slide, I think, is also really a crux, that because of the poor communication, sometimes there's a discordance between the information that the decision maker actually needs and what the modeler actually provides. Okay. Models contain too much math. Models are too complicated, and that's even with Cotty's and Ben's four or five books, or I don't know, at the last count, but even with wonderful ways to visualize these things, I don't think we're still there for some of the decision makers. I see an unresolved tension between the reductionist and holistic thinking still, and between simple and complex models. I'll jump to the end, the desire for a single answer. It's very related to this. There are still people who, after 30 years of looking for a magic bullet, say to cancer, and they're still, oh, maybe if there's one more pathway that we haven't discovered, we will get that magic bullet. And it doesn't matter that after 30 years of magic bullet thinking and reductionist thinking not bearing fruit, it's still, that seems to be this human desire and need. Well, wow, maybe we'll just have a simple answer and we'll get it and it's right around the corner. And so you spend another 10 years looking for the magic bullet, and now you're at 40 years of looking for magic bullets and still not finding them. So I find that tension still very strong. Boundary space that's either too narrowly or too widely defined. There's, to me, an unresolved tension between problem and solution focused thinking. So I've built teams where I take architects and artists and people with different disciplines, and the way they think about solving a problem and the solution set, sometimes there's no overlap. And so I'm going to argue for whole brain thinking, not left and right brain, but whole brain thinking. We need people who think about problems in very different ways, in very complex ways, and there's not one answer to this. Models lack face validity. I can't tell you how many times at the end of the day the user just takes a look at it and says, well, that doesn't make any sense. So it just discredits the whole thing. Clearly, there are also failed efforts to replicate and validate models, unresolved differences in expectations about the modeling process. So I think this is really important. And I've actually, this is one thing I'm going to read because I believe it's a quote from Josh Epstein in 2008, but he talked about what models should be used for. So, and the context was a meeting where we were trying to understand modeling social behavior. And the meeting started with people saying, well, models are all about prediction, models are all about forecasting. And Josh and a couple of other people stood up and said, no, it's not what they're all about. So the quote, models help us explain observations, understand systems dynamics, illuminate uncertainties, offer options for interventions, set boundaries of parameters and outcomes, discipline our thinking, and identify new questions. Since 2008, I haven't heard anyone do it better. And I think this, the difference in expectations, I'm still in meetings almost every day where somebody says, well, what's the answer? What's the prediction? Can I believe it? Not understanding that the whole process of building the model itself is incredibly informative. I know scientists at NIH, for example, that never publish the results of their model. They use the model to help them test their assumptions and to make the next step so they can then do the next experiment. The model itself is not what's published. It's just the part of the exercise to learn and go to the next step. It's a formal way of questioning what it is that you're doing and why you're doing it. And I think this is often lost on decision makers and it's not explained. So, and of course, the last one, model results are that are unwelcome. I'm sure there are examples that you've all had where you walk in and say, here's what the model results show, and there's kind of like a blank face, and then you realize, oops, that's doesn't fit in with the preconceived notion, and sometimes it's hard to sort of go beyond that. So that is my talk, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any quick clarifying questions? Yes?
So you note that one reason that models aren't used is because they contain too much math. What's the solution to that? Do we get the math out of the models, or do we move toward a world in which models can include math?
A study, and I can't quote the citation, but there's actually a study where they took the same paper and they kept the math in and they took the math out and they sent it around to major journals. And the more math, the less likely, in the biological sciences and in the biomedical sciences, the less likely it was to be published. So part of my day job is to encourage the integration of math and statistics and computer science and to cross-train a whole new generation. So I hope it's a matter of time where the fact that people are not comfortable with math, it's like, well, really, that existed back then when you were like an old fart or whatever? So I just think it's a matter of time because the programs that we're helping fund, some of the students when I go to the universities, they get this stuff. They're just so mathematically literate. It's incredible.
All right, we're going to move to our second panelist today, who is Rick Parra, who is with the Air Force Office of Scientific Research.
All right, I'm going to start by trying to manage my expectations first. How many people with a show of hands has ever heard of the Air Force Office of Scientific Research? Okay, so I can't lie too much today. All right. So my name is Rick Parra. I am a program officer with AFOSR, and what I was want to try to follow Susan's directions and try to stay very brief so we have time for a lot of questions and answers. And I'm going to try to show you just a quick snapshot of who we are, how do you know it. Hopefully what I'm telling you is what you think it is. And then in doing so, maybe give you a little bit of an insight as to one, how we make decisions, as well as also sort of how do we actually go about discussing the impact of the science that we fund. So, this works, that's awesome. So our mission is there, I won't read it, but thing to keep in mind, what to take away from this is that we're a 6-1 funding agency. When I use the word 6-1, that's DOD speak for basic research. DOD likes to break things into three buckets, 6.1, 6.2, and 6.3. It was somebody's spreadsheet a long time ago, the basic, applied, and then technology development. We are entirely 6.1, we're entirely basic research. So in some senses, it's sort of like, we're kind of like an NSF, but if NSF worked for the Air Force, that's kind of what we do. We mostly work via grants to universities, and there's a whole bunch of numbers about how many graduate students we fund, how many postdocs we fund, etc. Now, let me give you first some funding perspective, just so we are all on the same page. The areas of these circles is proportional to how much money they have. So you got NIH on one side, you got NSF, and then we're there on the right hand. Okay? Now, if we were to compare to within sort of the DoD and our sister agencies, so we're looking at the Navy and the Air Force, here's three circles. The solid circles is how much basic research money each of the services get. Okay, so again, this is the Navy, the Air Force, and the Army. But all three of them are very different in the way they manage that money. In fact, you couldn't make them any more different if you tried to. So if you look on the left, that's ONR, the Office of Naval Research. Yes, they handle that kind of money. However, ONR is way, way bigger than that little circle. And that's that sort of other circle that's white. That's how much they actually handle 6.1, 6.2, and 6.3. They're like a one-stop shop for all that S&P. The Air Force, which is in the middle, we only handle 6.1. And all the money will only handle basic research. And all the basic research that Congress gives the Air Force goes through us. So in that sense, it's kind of intuitively a very simple picture. The Army, on the other hand, they also get an equivalent level of 6.1 money from Congress, but the Army Research Office actually only handles a small portion of that. In fact, about a third of the 6.1. So they're a little bit smaller. So we are structured in roughly, we take that money and we break it up in roughly 40 portfolios. So there's, right now, I think that if you actually count is about 37, 38, but roughly 40 historically. So that means that there's about 40 other copies of me running around in our building, acting as program officers for all these various areas of research. Some of them sound fairly, I'll dare use the word applied, like hypersonics, but all others sound like atomic and molecular physics. They sound very basic research. In here, if you were to guess where I am, I'll point it out. I'm the guy all the way to the left. And the name of my portfolio, so my daytime job, is a ultra short pulse laser matter interaction. So if anybody is into ultra short pulse laser matter interactions, please come and talk to me. I would love to talk to you. So how do we actually, one more thing. We actually have offices overseas, ONR and Army, they do as well. I think this slide used to say, oh, the sun never sets on AFOSR. It's very dramatic. I like that slide. But now somebody changed it. I'm not that happy with it. However, we have an office in London that handles sort of the European section. We have an office in Tokyo for Asia. And then we have an office that is in Santiago, Chile. Okay. We also, if you want to know about all the portfolios, who's the program officer for which one, and sort of get into the details, we actually have a page on the APAN website. You probably have never heard of the APAN website. However, if you Google AFOSR APAN, you get to this collaboration place. And in there, we have a page, and all of our portfolios are listed in there. We have links to our meetings. So if you want to know, all our meetings are open. You know, basically, research public, you know. So anybody can go, there's no registration fee. So if you're interested in hypersonics, you can look up the portfolio when the next hypersonics contract review meeting is. They're all in DC, just attend if you want. So if you want to know about AFOSR, this is a great way to sort of learn about us and do a little bit of homework. Now, in the APAN website, we also have two very good documents. We have the AFOSR 60th monograph. It's a very nice, lots of pictures, story of AFOSR has been around for 64 years, of all the various things that we funded in that time frame. And then, I didn't put a date on it, but I think 2 years ago, we put together the technical strategic plan that sort of lays out a little bit more like how we do what we do and what we're looking at going into the future. In terms of how we talk about the impact of our funding, and this is going to be true for most of the DoD, we tend to use anecdotes a lot. We tend to use a lot of narratives. In fact, over the last 60 years, we've had a hand in funding a whole range of different technologies. The laser was funded by the FOSR. The original roadmap that laid out a human-computer interface that ultimately became the computer mouse, that was funded by AFOSR. Cell, if any of you have heard of a Kalman filter, that got us to the moon, so you can thank us. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, I'm not kidding, I can't thank us, but a lot of people funded that. GPS, and a whole series of things going all the way to now to graphene, electrical atoms, etc. In fact, in the 64 years that we've been around, we've actually funded 78 Nobel Prize winners. And on average, not after they got the Nobel Prize, I'm asking that question, but on average, 17 years before they got the Nobel Prize. So that's the kind of legacy. And in fact, I did a little digging, and I realized we also funded back in 1964, only 2 years after AFOSR got stood up, Eugene Garfield. I highlighted some of the things there. So that paper, which I see it cited all the time, was funded by AFOSR. I didn't realize it, but it's up there. So those are the slides that I have. Okay, look at that. I'd love to engage in a discussion during the panel. But I guess the reason, you probably want to know that today, but why are you here, Rick? Why are you talking to us? You don't really fund this area, which is true. And you just told us you have a little bit of money. So you don't even have that much money. So why are we even listening to you? That's a good question. However, one more thing, the fact that we don't even, the way we make these decisions, like I said, it's anecdotal. We come up with stories, with narratives. We'd love to get up and say, oh, I can tell you about Fred or something, and we discovered this, and I saw it. As soon as I saw the proposal, I knew right there and then that was going to be a breakthrough. However, we have a nice, strong legacy of things that we did find. So we would love to be able to go into a future where we do a little more data-driven, do a data-based sort of intuition, if you will. I think we're at a point where we could use a lot more situational awareness. There's a lot of stuff happening, a lot of people doing a lot of research, and can't even keep up, let's do the papers, can't even keep up with the titles of the papers that are being published. So how do you handle that, and how do you then make smart decisions? In other words, if I give you, say, 100K, and I said, okay, fiscal year end is coming up, you have 100K, you gotta put it on a grant. What do you find? What do you do? Those are the sort of decisions that we face. We don't work with panels. We're not like the NSF. We don't have a team of 14 academics that get together and review these things. We receive the proposals typically. We have telecon, there's a white paper, then another telecon, we talk all the time. And eventually we get a proposal. That proposal we submit for peer review, send it out much in the same way that a paper would get sent for review at a publisher. And I should add that we pick the reviewers. I'll let you think about that. And then at the end, that's what we find. So we have quite a bit of autonomy. The problem with autonomy is, well, it's great if you have it, but you also want to make sure that you have that transparency and that accountability. And that's the part where I'm here today, in some senses, sort of as a customer, as a potential future customer for sort of the science of science, for understanding, you know, how science really works, and trying to draw from that and ask the question, should we be doing things a little bit differently? There are a lot of different funding mechanisms that we have. We have the NERIs, the DERRs, the YIPs, all those of the acronyms for funding mechanisms. Are those the right funding mechanisms? We don't need to ask these questions at all. So I think it's about time to start doing that. And I'm here to kind of say, hey, some of us at least there are listening. So I'd love to take any thoughts offline, online, whatever. Thank you.
Okay, well, is there anyone who has a clarifying question? No, okay, good, but you're thinking about your question to bring to the panel. Okay, so, and our third panelist today is Brian Pate, who is with the United States Department of Defense, so he will be a good check on whether what Rick told us was actually true or not.
All right,
So within the Department of Defense, I'm actually at an agency called the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, which is the lead for the Department of Defense in countering weapons of mass destruction. So I would echo many of the things that Rick just said about the reason that I'm here as a potential customer. And I want to walk you through a little bit more detail about the mission of the Defense Threat Reduction Agency and some of our areas of emphasis that relate to data analytics. And then I'll show you one current funding opportunity in this space and make you aware of the general way in which you can collaborate with the Defense Threat Reduction Agency. And so the mission, as I sort of alluded to, is countering chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear weapons. And so I guess what's unique about DTRA is that we are focused solely on these chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear weapons, as well as some emphasis on high-yield explosives. We exist within a combat support agency, so as opposed to the ONR, AFOSR, ARO that you just heard about, DTRA is designated as a combat support agency. So we have the six basic research through prototype development funding, and then we're also have a mission of providing 24/7 operational and advisory support to the commanders on the battlefield when they potentially are going to encounter a issue that entails weapons of mass destruction. There we go. So the things that are then going to be applicable within this arena are the fact that there's a certain urgency and immediacy because of the fact that these threats can have high consequences even though they're low probability events. So we need to be able to anticipate or game or model the potential effects of a very low probability event where we don't have extensive experimental data that would apply to particular scenarios. In terms of trends that we see, we want to counter the threats as far upstream as possible. We have global partnerships, interagency efforts. We are also moving towards the traditional non-proliferation timelines to be able to get into more of a countering terrorist events. So within the research and development arm of the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, the emphases are on enhancing strategic deterrence through capabilities such as system survivability, forensics, targeting of weapons of mass destruction sites, being able to protect the warfighter using environmental sensing, personnel protection, collective protection, medical diagnostics and countermeasures, post-attack responses, being able to counter weapons of mass destruction, terrorism, and proliferation. So this would involve things like being able to assess threats, being able to identify the sites where weapons of mass destruction are being stockpiled or produced, being able to defeat those activities, and provide support to special operations units that might be involved in those activities, and then being able to characterize and predict the dispersal of a hazard. This is one of the models that would inform a dispersion based on certain census data and climatic data, weather conditions of a particular release, and this would be used to inform advice that was given to commanders or to local response units in responding to a release. There's a need to maintain situational awareness around the globe of these sorts of events, and so enabling all of these somewhat more applied activities are investments in basic research and advanced analytics et cetera. So some of the more specific activities under this framework, we have a program that's known as the Biosurveillance Ecosystem that is designed to bring together data, tools, and users in a cloud-based self-sustaining web that would allow for informing using various social media tools, et cetera, together with private cloud data, be able to gain an earlier awareness of a potential outbreak of a disease, right? And this is obviously in collaboration with entities like the Center for Disease Control. Other activities that pertain to getting further ahead of a threat, but less on a population level and more on the individual level, are the investments that Ditcher's making in leveraging the current activity within the wearables arena towards chem bio exposure monitors. And so traditionally, the goal here is to be able to, as opposed to this traditional model where we're exposed to a biological warfare agent, for instance, and then eventually there's some degraded performance and then overt mission symptoms. And then we think, once these overt symptoms are noticed, to apply our diagnostics and eventually therapeutics. There's a large rise in the curve here of mission disruption, arbitrary scale, obviously. What we'd like to be able to do is, using these wearable monitors, to be able to get an earlier cue that something, like a check engine light, that something could be wrong, so that we would then apply time course, the diagnostics and therapeutics to result in less mission degradation. So the theme here is getting ahead of the threat to increase the readiness of our warfighter and civilian populations. If we think about at a higher level about how do we even identify threat areas, right? How do we identify emerging technologies that might in the future either pose threats as weapons of mass destruction or in catalyzing weapons of mass destruction use or proliferation? Or how do we identify the technologies that might help us with really breakthrough game-changing countermeasures to weapons of mass destruction that already exist? And so right now this is really an expert-driven approach. And so we partner with the intelligence community for the near term to identify threats, agents of concern, to provide input from the intelligence community based on what they're seeing around the globe to priorities. Within the ChemBio part of DITRA, since this is really focused on the ChemBio technologies in this slide, there would be a providing characterization of threat agents and potential technologies of concern, but again, really informed by expert analysis. And then this is an iterative cycle that can identify things like, the CRISPR sort of technologies that are in the news right now, to be applied to things like synthetic probiotics or targeted nano delivery platforms. Either from a positive or a negative sense, either as useful technologies for countering weapons of mass destruction or as potential threats of concern. Now, this is basically how we do it today, and we put out topics and offers respond to these topics, or we directly task some of the lab, the Chem Biodefense Lab PIs that we have within the government. So we're in this space of focused, expert-driven discovery. Okay, and Ditcher put out a request for information a few months ago that really tried to understand the scope of tech forecasting methods that were being applied in the community, and out of that came this quadrant approach to synthesizing or thinking about these areas where, and we really put ourselves down in this focused, expert-driven area. One can also think about expert-driven approaches that are applied more broadly to assess across a range of potential technologies that could be applied within this weapons of mass destruction domain. But we'd also like to be able to be better about applying data-driven methodologies, both within the focused realm of technology areas that we already see as pertinent to counter weapons of mass destruction, and then also that look more broadly across a wider range of potential technologies. And so this new tech forecasting strategic initiative is seeking to align, integrate these activities and share knowledge across these boxes and develop capabilities that are more data-driven and more broadly looking ultimately, so that we can get out of the box of our lists of threat agents, right, that are known biological and chemical warfare threats. And then also thinking about applications within the nuclear and radiological threat arena. So the goal ultimately then is to develop an agency capability to anticipate technology-driven emerging disruptive weapons of mass destruction threats. And the current solicitation that I mentioned that I wanted to at least bring to your attention, because I think that some of you in this room could apply to this, because it's currently out, I can't say a whole lot about it other than to give you a screenshot of the solicitation. And to make you aware of the dates, so let me scroll down a little bit here. So right now, it's called Data-Driven Technology Discovery Methodologies. It was released April 22nd. It has an application deadline of June 22nd, so 36 days from now, I guess. And it's right now in a period of time where one can pose questions to the technical point of contact on the topic. So the objective, and that person's name is listed here, it's not me. So Reed Grabowski. It is information, you're free to call him or email him with specific questions about this topic. The objective is to develop sustainable and scalable data-driven methodologies to discover emerging or disruptive technologies before they have an innovative impact on weapons of mass destruction and that mission space. Of countering those. And for this first effort, within phase one, you see that it's focused on the methodology for focused data-driven discovery. So moving to the right from focused expert-driven discovery to a more of a methodology that's still focused within the chemical, in particular biological threat arena, what you'll see from as you read through the solicitation. But is focused on applying data-driven methods for discovery of emerging or disruptive technologies that could be applicable within the biothreat arena. Okay, so I've probably already said too much. I won't say any more than that. But you know, I would encourage you to read through the solicitation, and to contact Reed with further questions. I will say that SBIR. Solicitation is just a preliminary one. One could imagine that DITRA might be gearing up for a broad agency announcement in this space as well. So I think reading through the SBIR language, even if you're not a company, might be informative to you for thinking about DITRA's longer-term interest in this area. There could be a broad agency announcement that comes out. But we also have current broad agency announcements that don't have a specific topic in this area. But I would encourage you, if you have an interest that could be applied to the countering weapons of mass destruction mission space, to reach out to me. And we can. We have a number of just open solicitations, a fundamental research broad agency announcement that has a very generic topic that's anything relevant to countering weapons of mass destruction, which could include data analytics or forecasting that's relevant to this space. And so some of these other solicitations are listed here. And this is my contact information if you would like to discuss a methodology that you think might be possibly applicable within this arena. Thanks.
Okay, any questions for Brian quickly? No. Okay, then we're going to move to our final speaker for the panel, and it is Daniel Goroff from my colleague at the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation.
thank you. So I'm Daniel Goroff, and the first thing I have to say is that my remarks do not necessarily represent the opinions of the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, but they should. So I want to start with the story of Isidore Isaac Robbie. So some of you may have heard of him. His work on magnetic resonance led to everything from better radar to microwave ovens to medical imaging. And it also led to him winning the Nobel Prize in 1944. And if you're like most of us, perhaps you spend time wondering what you would say in Stockholm if you had to give a laureate's address. Well, when he gave his laureate address in Stockholm, he naturally thanked his mother, as one does. And he was very specific, though, in thanking his mom for one very specific habit that she had, which was that every day when young Robbie came home from school, she did not ask him if he had what he had answered in class that day. She did not ask him anything about the answers he had given in class that day. Instead, she wanted to know if he had asked a good question. And that emphasis on the value of formulating questions instead of answers is what Robbie credited as the reason why he ended up winning a Nobel Prize. Now, you can learn about this in an old book about Robbie that was supported with funds from the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, where I work now. So let me turn to Mr. Sloan and his questions, and I'll come back to this issue of questioning and its importance. So I hope everybody knows that Mr. Sloan is the person who put together and ran General Motors. He started the Sloan School of Management at MIT, Memorial Sloan Kettering. There are Sloan buildings all over the place on campuses, and he also started the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. And his instructions to us were to support research and some outreach, NPR and PBS, for example, about science, technology, and economics. So beside NSF, we're one of the few funders who work both on science and economics. Therefore, the economics of science is of particular interest to us. So we're particularly fascinated and want to understand the productivity of the whole scientific enterprise. So that in all of its glory and with all of its peculiarities. So that includes questions about labor markets and practices, about incentives and innovations, and of course about the role of research funding. So I hope that sounds pretty great to most of you, and that you're, but before you get too excited, let me also tell you that we're not particularly interested in policy research. So by policy research here, though, I mean the kinds of projects that many other philanthropies, not necessarily the ones here, but many other philanthropies fund. And those are projects that are subject to what behavioral economists call the confirmation bias. So here's how it works. You know what the answer is that you want, and you just find some people who are willing to write up that answer in exchange for some money. And if they put some statistics and footnotes at the end of the paper, then everybody's happy. So we just don't do any of that kind of work, and we tend to refer to it as policy research. We don't do any advocacy, and we read the IRS regulations as really not being consistent with that. But, and this is a big but, although we're not funding what I just called policy research, we're intensely interested in policy-relevant research. So that's honest-to-goodness research, and it's the kind of work that's inspired by Isidore Isaac Robbie and the way he put the questions first. So when we look at proposals, we want to see good questions, we want to see good methodologies. The answers will come out however the answers come out, and our attitude is let the preponderance of the best evidence win in the marketplace of ideas, and that's it. So we have no ideology, no preconceptions. We just really want to fund very good research. And let me illustrate how this emphasis on the questions rather than on the outcomes work out at the Sloan Foundation by citing just three areas that we're working on these days. So one is transparency and reproducibility. Another is very specifically about, I want to say something about modeling and prediction. And the third is about administrative data and data access. So about reproducibility, some people say that we're in a kind of a crisis about all of this, that science doesn't reproduce as well as it should. Certainly there's a lot of false discovery around, and it's not a matter of fraud, but simply it's researchers doing what it takes to get published. So you need statistical significance, and formally that means that the probability P of having gotten the data that you observed has to be less than 5%. Under the null hypothesis that you're working under, and then, you know, bingo, the duck drops down and you get to publish your paper. So some people will do almost anything to get P less than 0.05. And if you think about it, if you test 100 hypotheses or 100 model specifications, then 5% of them are going to turn out to be statistically significant just because of noise. And if you only publish that 5% and the 95% say in your file draw, this is sometimes called the file draw problem, then the published evidence is very different from the total amount of evidence that's available. So this is a common discussed problem, sometimes called, as I mentioned, the file draw problem. It's also related to p-hacking, hypothesis phishing, data dredging. So what's the solution? One solution is to commit to answering certain questions using certain methods in advance. So again, very consistent with Isidore Isaac Rabi. And you do that by registering your experiment, registering your research in advance. And that is why the Sloan Foundation actually is set up, together with the American Economic Association, a registry where you can put that kind of information down and make that kind of commitment. And I'll just say that if you, rather than experimenting on the fly and trying this, trying that, and then just reporting the final one that worked. So that's very consistent with our way of viewing grants. And I'll just say that if you want to apply to the Sloan Foundation, you really better have a hypothesis, you better have an analysis, you better have committed to all these sorts of things, and you better have an appendix where you've done your power calculations, because we're just going to send it back to you if you don't. So that's part of our guidelines for all of this, and it's just consistent with this idea of wanting to see a very good question, very good methodology, and the outcomes will come out as they do. So that's number one. The second thing I wanted to say was about modeling and prediction. So George Box is famous for saying that all models are wrong, but some are useful. And I think that that's an important idea to keep in mind, because what you ignore when you make a model, because after all, it's just a model, what you ignore depends on the questions that you want to answer. So you really should have questions in mind when you go about making a model, rather than just, oh, let me see what I can do with this data and see if somebody might be interested in it. So you need to have those up front. And to my mind anyway, policy relevant questions, remember I said policy relevant questions, are really not often about prediction. I'm really not so interested in what's going to happen next. And I'm not interested in models that predict all that well. And I'm really not interested in people who come to me and say, well, we're going to find patterns. There are lots of patterns in anything. Give me some random data set. I'll find you tons of patterns, and most of it's going to be noise. The question about policy is not about predictions. It's about if-then statements. If I do this, then that will happen. And it's very hard and usually quite provably impossible to answer those kinds of if-then questions by simply making observations. You can't do it, because all you know is the observations under the present circumstances, and not what would happen if I change this dial or that parameter by so much. So you need causal inference. You need an identification strategy based on usually some exogenous shock to the system or some kind of natural experiment that you can do that allows you to estimate the coefficient of the variable that you want to do some policy on. So if you can say that that coefficient is beta and accurately get it, the variable you want to change is x, then you might be justified in saying, if I change x by some percentage, by 1%, then the result will change by beta percent. That's the kind of question I'm really interested in. And unless you have a serious way of modeling all that, just making predictions is not so much of interest to me personally. And I'll just mention that instead, what I would like to see is not just these descriptive kinds of theories, or even predictions, or even prescriptive kinds of theories, but I'm looking for something normative about science and about the scientific enterprise. So in a lot of economics, it's terribly useful, if wildly idealistic, to talk about the ideal free market, because it gives you a standard to compare things to, and then you know what you're competing against, and it helps you identify inefficiencies. So for example, I don't know what the ideal setup is for a scientific enterprise, but I do know that having lots and lots of postdocs spend lots and lots of their most creative years working on other people's projects for 10 or 20, and with lousy benefits and everything, that cannot be efficient. That is not a way to run a system. And so we need to have some kind of normative theory of what's really better than that. And those are some of the kinds of questions that that really interest me personally. How to deploy, for example, research talent, how to handle a lot of the other kinds of functions of the scientific enterprise. So finally, about data and access, we get lots and lots of requests to collect data. And people send us all sorts of proposals, and they say, oh, it's really going to be great. We're going to get this massive amount of data, and it's really going to be terrific. And I'll just tell you that everyone in the whole foundation reads every single proposal. We write about it. We get together. We actually read aloud what we wrote, which is kind of weird, but it works really well. But one of the worst things that you can write if you get a proposal like this is FOD. And that stands for Field of Dreams. And many of these proposals are just, if we build it, they will come. And we don't fund any of them. So what we're looking for, if you want to do something with data, is research questions that you've plunked down in advance, and researchers who actually want to use this data. Now, we fully understand that there will be, if we're at all lucky, dozens and dozens of other things that people will want to do with this data that we can't anticipate to begin with. But if you don't have researchers and research questions motivating your assembly of this data to begin with, then it's probably not going to come out to be as useful as it could have. And that's one of the criteria of what we're looking for, namely to have those kinds of questions and hypotheses. So I'll just give you one example of a data collection exercise like this that we have been doing, and that's called IRIS. It's the Institute for Research on Innovation and Science. We've helped set this up at the University of Michigan. And what they're doing is vacuuming up enormous amounts of administrative data from research universities. So HR data, grant spending data. And this is being linked with census data through the courtesy of our friends in the federal government. So that, for example, you can disambiguate and trace a person's career and say, finally, that they were supported as a graduate student on this grant, they worked in this laboratory, they went to that university, they got this patent, they worked with this other person, they were supported on this grant, and so on and so on. So you can trace through the effect of the kinds of federal funding and the kinds of other funding, including philanthropic funding, I hope, to the success of the research enterprise. So this is very exciting, and it goes to the question of the classic question of what is the return on investment in scientific research. Sometimes I call this the Grillikus question, but it's the sort of thing that we're very interested in for lots and lots of reasons that I can talk about later. And it's an example of what we're doing with administrative data altogether. So we have a solicitation out about the handling of administrative data, not just from universities, but in lots of different arenas, and including the privacy issues and lots of other issues. And so I hope that you'll ask me questions about that later, because who knows, when you go home, your mother might ask you what questions you were asking.
I think. So do we have anyone who wants to make a quick observation? I didn't realize we had four speakers in 1 hour, and when you ask people to talk for 5 minutes, they will always talk for 15 minutes. So we are out of time. But if anyone has a quick observation or a comment or something, this is a great time to do it while we're sort of getting the next panel organized. Yes, please. Great, thank you. I think that also captures some of the points I was trying to make about what we value, because I think that's also critically important. There's sometimes we think we know what's the right thing to do. Yeah.
This is to the AFOSR. This is a plea for additional help in finding opportunities that are available overseas. Your sister organizations, ONR and Army Field Office, have literally two people and a dog in their offices. I helped set up the office in Santiago. And understanding what's happening with 80% of the R&D, which happens outside the borders of the United States, is almost impossible. It tends to be very anecdotal, very personal, and knowing where the opportunities are and where the real progress is being made has been a continuous effort. Data mining, we've tried. It has been in fits and starts. So if there's anything that modeling and can help with identifying where those opportunities are, because AFOSR, ONR, and the Army really emphasize the integration of overseas researchers with Americans to really further the enterprise and help prevent strategic surprise. That's the main mission.
Okay, and I hope that you'll buttonhole everyone as they've invited you to do during breaks and informal time and ask any other additional questions you may have. Thank you very much.